would have the honor of taking Guyana forward when you elect him on May 11th as your president?
Honorable Prime Minister and Mrs. Hines, ministers of the government, here, Ms. Elizabeth Harper, future Prime Minister of Guyana, and Mr. Mark Harper, former President Barrett Jagdeo, General Secretary of the PPP, Mr. Clement Rohi, comrades and friends all. I have been president of our country over the last 3 years. These were not easy years. In fact, they were very, very trying years. It did not have to be so. I had hoped that it would not have been so. Indeed, you will recall that when I opened the 10th Parliament of Guyana and I spoke there, I said then that the fact that the joint opposition had a one-seat majority should not necessarily stop the progress of our country. I reached and I said that then, even though just before my speech, they took the position of they violated or they changed the tradition of parliament all over the world, where the speaker comes from the ruling party and the deputy speaker from the opposition. They took both positions as Speaker and Deputy Speaker. Even though when we had the majority, when in 1997 we had 39 seats in the Parliament, we still put them as the Deputy Speaker. But these people have shown then, since then, their intention. I said that we were ready to work together and appeal to them in the interest of the Guyanese people, in the interest of our country, that we should move and work together. Now, and I really tried. I tried hard to work with those people. I really did. I recall that when we had crafted the budget, when we were crafting the first budget in 2012, I asked Ashni Singh, our Minister of Finance, to consult with them, with all in the society. He had a trail of emails that he sent to them, and they did not turn up. Yet, When the budget was finished, they said they wanted to talk, and I accommodated them, and we had discussions. We had agreements with them, and I am proud to say, as is the tradition with the PPP, that we lived up to our commitments, to all the commitments that we gave, we lived up to them. And believe me, they did not live up to one. It was so glaring when we had the agreement on the electricity situation at Linden. Prime Minister Samuel Hines announced in Parliament that this agreement we had with the opposition. But before he announced the agreement with them, the decent man that he is, he showed them the statement that he would have made and asked them if he had captured the essence of the agreement, and they agreed yes. Yet, 2 or 3 hours after that announcement was made, Mr. Granger said, we did not have an agreement. This is what we had to work with. This is the situation that we had with them. And that led, they misled the people at Linden. And that led to some of the problems there, in which unfortunately 3 persons lost their lives. But that was not all. They continued to instigate. They continued to instigate and went and had riots, trying to bring riots to the city. They went and had disturbances in Agricola. Moreover, that during the situation at Linden, Mr. Granger and I met and we agreed immediately to set up a commission of inquiry into what took place at Linden. And they even said they wanted to have foreigners. They didn't want to have Guyanese. They wanted to have foreign elements to do the commission of inquiry. At great expense, we set up the commission to look into the situation. And lo and behold, even before the commission completed its work, they were already trying to denigrate the work of the commission and trying to attack Rohi, demanding his resignation. My friends, as I have said, I really tried, but that was not all. That was not all. Even though they showed in 2012 they cut the budget and we had to go to the court to put back much of the needed money into the budget, I still invited them again, both parties. That time they were not married as yet. They were having intercourse in the toilet. But I invited both of them to come to talk about the important programs that we have. The important programs to develop Guyana. By then we were close to having an agreement to build the Amaila Falls. They came, we gave them a full explanation, all the documents we gave them. Then again, I told them then that I was ready to deal with any questions that they had. And if they didn't have any questions then they can go away and consult with whoever they wanted to consult with and come back to me, and I will get answers for them. They have no questions. When we were about to sign the deal, again I invited them to speak, and they came, and then they said to me, but we would like to see the road. We would like to see the falls. We took them on the road, took them on a walkabout on the road, flew them over the falls. They came back and told the press good things. But when it came to voting, they voted against the Amaila Falls. I tell you this, I'm telling you this today, because I do not get the time to always answer them with their misrepresentation and their half-truths and lies. And one of the things that they have been saying is that we do not consult. But we consulted them extensively, extensively. But they do not want to be consulted sometimes. They want to create problems to damage the development of our society. My friends, all their actions over the last 3 years were designed to damage our country. I told you, we heard, you know about the budget cuts. And you know the charges that they have been making, saying it was illegal to put back the cuts, even though the courts agreed to put back the money into the budget. But the important thing to look at is what they were trying to cut. What they were cutting is important to note. You heard one of the things they wanted to cut. They wanted to cut out the money that the government put to the revolving loan for university students. Students who cannot afford to pay the fees will borrow the money and will go to and get a tertiary education and will not have to pay back that money until they have finished their courses. That is what they were cutting from the budget. What else were they cutting from the budget? What else? You know that in the interior communities of our country has huge possibilities for development, and it's on the verge of taking off, and those areas in the future will become even more important as the driving forces and the centers for economic development of Guyana. And therefore, we have been building the human capital there by expanding on education and health. And now we're spending to help the village economy so that the interior population, mainly Amerindians, can catch up with the people on the coastal areas. They cut the complete capital budget. These are the same people who are now going to look for votes in those communities, and they cut the complete budget in the Amerindian communities. My friends, you know, last year, we gave the parents so that they can take the burden off of them in sending their children to school. We gave them $10,000 for every child in school. My friends, they had cut that from the budget. If we didn't put it back, we would not have been able to do what we did last year. That is the things they were cutting, things that affected people, cutting money from the hospital, from the airport. But let me tell you, there are three stories that point out completely their total intention, what their intentions are. The airport money that they cut this year, last year, in 2013, they voted for it. They voted for the airport project in 2013. 2014, they voted against. What is diabolical about that? Is that by agreeing to it in 2013, we went into contractual arrangements with these people, and now they want to cut it, which will open us to litigation in the court and costing this country billions of dollars. That is what they did. There's another case. There's a company that took this government to court. An environmental tax on plastic bottles. We had to go to Parliament to change the law so that we can equalize the tax with CARICOM countries. They refused to change the law, and the Caribbean Court of Justice put a big charge on us, millions and millions of dollars. It shows that they had never had any intention of developing Guyana. That, and the third one, to show how they were damaging our country, was the anti-money laundering bill. You know, we have spoken about that extensively. But that vote, that bill, was to give us the laws necessary to fight against drug traffickers and money launderers, to not only jail them, but to take their property. The opposition on two occasions, not one, but on two occasions, they voted against passing this bill. So what were they doing? What were they doing when they did that? By their vote, they vote to put the Guyanese nation in jeopardy and sided with the criminal elements in our society. These are the same people who talk about security but refuse to pass the anti-money laundering bill. My friends, and again, they wanted to cut. Last year, in order to help the sugar industry that is going through some difficult times, we voted to give the industry $6 billion. They were going to cut it. In fact, APNU voted against giving money to the sugar industry. And yet, shamelessly, Mr. Granger is now saying the same party that voted against giving the sugar industry money, he's now changing his tune. Sugar is too big to fail. An electoral gimmick, they're going to attack all of these things that we have been doing. Comrades, despite the opposition's tremendous attack on us, despite all of that, despite their lack of cooperation and the lies and slander that they continue to expose our country, and although also we have an international environment that is difficult, many, many prices on our commodities are now down on the world market. Despite all of that, our country continues to make progress. Over the last 3 years, every year, we have had positive economic growth, 4.5% or 5%. If we had the majority in the parliament, our country would be growing by 10% per annum. But we still achieve quite a lot. We have big investments in our country now. In every sector, we have huge investments in gold, in diamond, in manufacturing, in searching for oil. We have investment. We have managed to keep inflation down. We work tirelessly on keeping the cost of living down. When we give free school books to our children, textbooks, exercise books, when we give assistance for school uniforms, where else does that happen anywhere in the world? When we give them meals in school, we are helping you to keep your cost of living down. So apart from the economic measures that we take, managing our fiscal and monetary policies to keep prices down, apart from that, those other measures contribute to keeping the cost of living down. Comrades, in 2013, we had the lowest inflation rate ever since our country became independent. Our debt had been reduced when the PNC APNU, when they changed the name. But who wants to change their name? Who changed their name? Only scamps and criminals hiding from the law. They are the people who change their name. Because even nowadays, when women get married, they don't change the name, they add on another name on it. Comrades, when they were there, we had our debt was 700% the size of our GDP, our economy, our whole economy. Today, it is 60%. 60%, and then they talk about governance and management. How can they talk about these things? As the comrades mentioned just now, we have a record that we can stand on. We have a record that we are proud of. We have a record that we can defend. That is why they're changing their names. But it's the same old PNC. Same old PNC we're dealing with. Comrades, we have had tremendous strides in education. Recall that we, many, many children could not get a secondary school education. We did not have, all our children of primary school age could not find place in schools. And only 30% of those that were leaving primary schools could have gotten into secondary schools. But you know, comrades, we solved that. Today we have all our children in primary school age going to school, in schools. We built or we refurbished more than 1,000 schools since we got into government. A revolution has taken place in this country. And more than that, today not only have we solved the education and primary education, we are very, very close to having universal secondary education in Guyana. Very soon, the minimum education in this country will be a secondary education in Guyana. My friends, look at housing, how much we have gone, how far we have gone. I still remember when I used to live in Albertong and I saw the landlord coming in the yard. I used to be scared. I think the man coming for raise the rent. But my friends, now people have their own homes. I myself did not get my own house until I was 48 years old or 48 years young. But a month ago or 6 weeks ago, I went to the West Demerara to look at the one-stop shop that they were having. And the one-stop shop that they were having there. And you know what I found? That people of 24 years old, 26 years old, are having their own homes. That is what it talk about caring for young people. So when they get married, they ain't gonna live home with mother-in-law. Got mother-in-law, daughter-in-law, that always got some jealousy among them. We don't have 2 and 3 families living together. We have reduced that problem considerably. And now, we're not only giving house lots, but houses are being built now for people. Young professionals can now have their own homes, can have their own home, their own roof over their heads. And then we have moved that program into the interior. I myself went to Whitewater and to Quatamang in the Rupununi area to open some new houses that people are having. The quality of life is definitely improving in every area of our country. And the PPP did it. The PPP Civic did that with no cooperation from the opposition. In fact, with terrible resistance from the opposition. And I promise you that when we win back the majority in the parliament, this time they will see how far we will go. Comrades, but elections, elections are also about the future, but also of where we are going. And that is what is very important. By the record of the opposition, we see that we cannot trust them with our future. Because being president, you must also have character. How can David Granger now say that he wants to pass the anti-money laundering bill when on 2 occasions he voted against it? How can he now talk about sugar too big to fail when he voted against assisting the sugar industry? Character is important. Character is important in high office of our country. All of these things How are they? For them, development is not their primary focus. Their primary focus is power, so that you can go after 12 and get Bob Twain in the office in Saturday afternoon. That is not their, whole trust is not for development. If you look at the negotiations that they had before they had this agreement, you will see what they were talking about. They were not talking about what program to develop Guyana. They were talking about who will be president, who will be prime minister, four vice presidents they want. They also want who will be finance minister, and the front runner is the worst finance minister that this country ever had. And they talk about who will be minister of home affairs. And the other man, what the man who was caught on tape, his voice authenticated on the tape, planning to plant cocaine on a woman who worked at Congress Place, their own comrade. This man is now in parliament. This was the same man, Felix. When he was commissioner, he couldn't catch a thief man. One week after he left office, the police broke up the gang in Buxton and saved the people in Buxton who were held hostage by those criminals. And he was the man with Basil Williams. You remember the gaffe on the telephone? When he told Basil Williams thank him. Basil Williams thanked Felix when the criminals killed 8 people on the east bank of Demerara before their bodies were cold. Basil Williams was thanking Felix for turning the thing away from the direction that it was going to the PNC. And Felix put out a fancy laugh. And then he said, yes, boy, I see it coming and I turn it away. But things exposed now, I can't cover up too much. These are the people who want to run our country. We cannot afford, because elections, it's about the future. And we are working in the PPP Civic. Very soon, we will bring out our manifesto. But we want to work to build a prosperous and a modern Guyana. To have a modern economy and a modern country. It means that we want to create a new knowledge-based economy. That is why we have been spending so much on education, to ensure that we attract investment in the country, not because of low wages and poor people, but because we will have a highly educated and skilled population. That is what we are doing. That is why I've told people this before, that if you want to see the difference between us and the opposition when they were in government, look at our budgets. Look at our budgets. They used to spend more money on the Ministry of Foreign Affairs than they spent on health, education, housing, water, and agriculture put together. This is their record. We know in a much bigger budget, more than 30% of our budget goes to the social sector, and the largest amount of that goes to education, to develop the quality of our people. Because It goes to our philosophy that the most important factor for development of our society or any society in the world is not only our natural resources, but the most important factor is the people of the country. And that is why we spend our money to develop our people in education. Now, we have the bill to do this, to build this modernized economy. We will have to build a new world class, because information and communication technology is now extremely important and indispensable in every sector of an economy. To create efficiency and to increase productivity. And therefore, we are ready. We have the plans. We have the source of financing. We will build the first ICT world-class ICT park right in Providence on the East Bank of Demerara. The first in Latin America, the first in the Caribbean. We will do that in the near future, when we are elected after May 11th. That will allow us to create even more highly skilled people, adding to the skills of our workforce. And we will become a magnet for people who want to invest in high-level jobs and high-level production, high-level technical jobs. We also want to develop our tourism, and we want it to be second to none in the world. And that is why it is important for us, and we also have identified the place at the University of Guyana. We have identified the resources to build a world-class hospitality center that will help our tourism sector to grow. We also will build a specialty hospital that will not only be a specialty hospital, but it will be a top-class teaching hospital. So we will train and retrain our doctors to be some of the best in the world. Right here in Guyana, we will do those things. Comrades, we are going to work to improve, to realign and reorient the University of Guyana to make it more ready to deal with this new economy that we are building. And we must also take into consideration, not only would these new industries come in, but we are on the verge of being a country. We will join the club of oil producing and gas producing countries in the world very, very soon. That of course will create thousands of jobs directly and indirectly in our society. But we have to prepare our people to be ready to manage that kind of economy and this new situation that is coming here with us. And comrades, to facilitate this, we will have to have cheap power. Cheap power is important and vital to this development. And that is why I promise you I promise you, once we're elected, re-elected, when we're elected on May 11th, we will build the Niagara Falls. We already identified the companies, and you know, already the opposition are trying to chase investors, coursing up the Chinese, coursing up the Russians, all over. How can they say that they want, they're friendly to investors and still trying to prevent them from coming to invest in our society? My friends, not only will we build the Niagara, but we will make energy. We will make energy another very important sector in our economy, that we can become an exporter, export energy to our neighbors by developing more of our hydro potentials in Guyana. And we have already been speaking to the Brazilians, that we're working with them to develop new hydroelectric sites so that we can take our country forward. Comrades, we cannot afford our future. We cannot afford this future. We see, as I told you, that these people want power for the sake of having power. We do not have that same interest, because, as you know, elections in this country are not constitutionally due until the beginning of 2017. I could have prorogued the parliament, call it back, prorogue it again, and extend the life of this government until next year. But we do not want to be in power if we cannot deliver goods and services to our people. We believe that would have created some uncertainty and affected our economy. And that is why, for us, power is only a means to an end, and the end is to ensure that every Guyanese got a comfortable life and a productive life in the country of their birth. That is what we are about. That is where our roots lie, from the time of Chedi Jagan right through to me now. And we will not change that philosophy of the PPP and the PPP city government. Comrades, we will need also, in the world that we are living in, where things are changing so fast, we have to prepare our country and ourselves. You know now, the Panama Canal is being expanded. More ships, bigger ships are coming into, more and more big ships are being man-made, built, 30, 40, 50,000 ton ships. Very soon, the 5 and 10,000 ton ships that come into our harbor, those things will become museum pieces. And we have to prepare our country for this new development. But we have the possibility of being not only an aerial hub because of where we are located geographically, but we have a possibility of being a maritime hub for the whole of South America and the Caribbean. And that is one of the reasons a deep water harbor is important to the economic and social development of our country. And we will tie that with the road, with the highway, connecting Linden to Latham, so that we will take about 6 hours from the coastal area to drive to Brazil. That is what we're about. We have been builders. The PNC have been broke up us. All their life they've known to broke up. Wreckers. That is what they are. Comrades, those are some of the things that we plan to do. But we are not neglecting our traditional industries. The sugar industry that has been the grandfather of all the industries in Guyana, and the industry that is most responsible for having most of us here, has made a tremendous contribution to the development of Guyana. No other sector, no other industry has done as much as sugar for the economic and social development of our country. But it has been going through some difficult times. It has been having impact of the price cut in sugar from Europe. In 2010, Europe removed the preferential treatment in sugar and the price went down by 36%. And today, we are price takers and the world market prices goes up and down all the time. But we need to insulate ourselves from this kind of fluctuation that is taking place. How do we do that? We have to modernize the industry too. And let me also say, some of the successes of the government has also had an impact on sugar. At one time, sugar was the only employer in many, many communities. Only you could have only got a job. They had no competition. But because of our country, it's growing, and growing at a rapid rate, faster than any other country in the Caribbean. There is now a lot of competition for labor in the industry. And it means, therefore, that we have to mechanize and modernize the industry. We have to spend money to retrain workers so that they will have higher paying jobs in a modernized sugar industry. We have to add new revenue streams, co-generation of electricity, distillery, the fuel alcohol, like we are already doing at Albion, we will expand that. New types of sugar, specialty sugars, many, many things we will do. And that is why I said before, and I repeat to you here now, that in the next few years, we will spend a minimum of $20 billion to ensure that sugar survives. Comrades, and our rice industry too. Our rice industry is growing. Imagine, Granger said the sugar industry, that is too big to fail. But his main sugar man, at a press conference in the new office, said we should shut the industry down and mine tilapia in the fields. Comrades, one of their main economic advisors last week, he got an article in the newspaper. He was prime ministerial candidate for Hoyt. Stanley Ming, he said that we will stop planting cane and plant some kind of thing. Keoli or Keora, I don't know what it is. And what I do know is whatever he's saying is not something that we plant in Guyana. This is what they said. The dishonesty, the double standards, and speaking to where the audience is without any conviction of their time. And for the rice industry too, you know, Greenwich, last week again, I could see how he broke up the country. You know what he said? In the newspaper that's there, he said that we don't need to be in rice. The government must not interfere in rice. Government must get out of the rice industry. And then I realized why in 1990 the production of rice went to 90,000 tons under Greenwich. Greenwich was the economic czar at that time. The same thing will happen again if God forbid and this economic zombie come to be Minister of Finance. Today, the rice industry is 600,000 tons. 600,000 tons. That is how far we have taken it. But we know that there are some problems always with the prices, and we would like to set up the conditions, set up the conditions to create a price stabilization so that people can predict, farmers can predict their incomes. And we have to modernize agriculture. We have to have new crops, not only rice and sugar, but soya, corn, coconut. Coconut can become as big as rice and sugar in our country. This is the direction we're going. And with a vibrant agriculture, I know that there probably are many agricultural teachers around, and we can have a powerful livestock industry in our country as well, where we will be producing our own feed. We can reach the stage of exporting chicken, exporting meat to the rest of the Caribbean and even beyond. These are some of the plans that we have. And moreover, for economic development to also take place, the infrastructure I've mentioned here before are important. We have to modernize our infrastructure and put on new infrastructure. And that is why we have already identified and working towards, we're trying to work towards another bridge across the Demerara River. But moreover, we have identified the money. We have identified the money to do a new road to connect the East Bank Highway with the East Coast Highway. In that way, we will be linking the Chedijagan International Airport with the Ogle Airport and linking all of that together. Improving transport is extremely important for the development of our society. We will move a new road, to go from Parika all the way opposite Bartika, where we will open new lands for different kinds of agriculture to develop our society. In the process, we will be able to create thousands of new jobs, highly paying jobs, not labor-intensive jobs alone. Not like the time when the PNC was in government and the only job they had was security work. but to have technical jobs so that our people can express themselves and they can need not go abroad to keep them home, to have the satisfaction of developing their own country. And comrades, we also will have to have in this process to continue to keep the cost of living down, continue to ensure that the standard of living every year will go up in our society. And we also have to do that in a secure environment. And that is why we have been investing more and more in our security forces. We have created a joint services so that they can share to some extent resources and work together in many areas to fight crime, to share intelligence, to deal with many of these things that we're dealing with. But we need, we also invested in a new forensic lab to use science and technology more in crime fighting and to improve the conviction rate. But you know that we have announced our 15 points to ensure that our security system improves and becomes stronger. We want to establish a neighborhood watch program. The goal of this program is to increase surveillance by residents and in the community as a whole, because we believe that people must also participate in their own security as well. We want to introduce a problem-oriented approach to addressing the crimes in our country, to have a clear focus on dealing with the problems, going to the root and dealing with issues. We will want to increase the numbers of policemen and women on the road. And we want to ensure that when you pick up the phone and call the police, we will ensure that when you pick up the phone and call the police, that they must be there. They must be there in half an hour at the time that you have called them. That is the program we are working towards, because we believe that they will be able to catch criminals in the act and they will be able to discourage criminals from participating and going into all of these type of criminal activities. We want to use established directed work because of the technology that exists. Police will have a better idea of the problem areas and can be able to move in those areas very, very quickly to stop crime and to strengthen. We already have a new SWAT team in place, and we want to build on that to ensure that they are able to fight serious and hardened criminals, to deal with them in our society, and to have more intelligence guided crime fighting possibilities, so that they can make surprise raids and capture more and more criminals. These are some of what we are doing. More of these we will see it in our manifesto. This is the direction that we go. Comrades, we have come a far way in Guyana. We have become the envy of many in the region and even beyond. Because when you take into consideration a time when we had serious financial and economic crisis in the world, when many Caribbean countries, through no fault of their own, have been forced to dismiss thousands of workers when in some places they have workers are accepting wage freeze and wage cuts. In Guyana, our country and our economy continues to grow. That is the kind of economic management that the PPP Civic has provided. And that is the kind of economic management that you can expect from us in the future. And that is why I ask all of you, I ask you individually, and I ask you collectively, on May 11th, I ask you to stand with me. I ask you to be with me. The PPP. The PPP has stood with the Guyanese people for 65 years, not only with the Guyanese people. I want you now, those of you who have not yet collected your ID cards, to go to your centers and collect your ID cards, to make an effort to do so. And I appeal to you to stand with me, to stand with Liz Harper, to stand with the PPP Civic, and let us take our country forward. Thank you for your attention.
Comrades, are you ready to stand by Guyana? Are you ready to stand by the PPP? Are you ready to take the party forward to victory? Then, come May 11th, you have a responsibility, and that responsibility is to go to the polls and place your X in the box beside the cup and ensure that we have the victory. Comrades, I say to you tonight, ask yourself one question. Is my life better off today than 20 years ago? Is my child life better off today than when I was a dairy age? And if the answer is yes, you have to reward your conscience by voting for the People's Progressive Party Civic on May 11th. Comrades, on behalf of our leaders, we thank you. We thank you for your support. We thank you for your loyalty, and we look forward to serve you!